going to pray, and then we're going to kind of do a bit of an overview. I'm going to kind of run through, sort of like if we were in a space station orbiting the planet philosophy, you know, and barely give you the 5 miles up view, so things are going to blur together a little bit. That can be very detailed in most cases. But I'm going to try to just give from all that stuff where we've been talking about where it all got born to where we are now. And then we'll still plug some stuff in during the next 3 weeks. But right now I'd like to have us just have a look at the landscape. Let's pray and we'll be on. Father in heaven, there's a real need somehow that our brains even seem to push us to decide and to get it, to understand something, nail it down, and move to the next something. Free us from that when it's not best, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. We talked about the fact that before the enterprise that we think of as Western philosophy came about, comma, according to the Western myth, comma, all right? Because I'm speaking within the Western narrative. Before this glorious enterprise of Western philosophical thought, the world was a place where people thought in a way inferior to this way, a way that doesn't get people to the moon, a way that doesn't help us to make skyscrapers, a way that doesn't help us to have proton accelerator cancer treatment centers and teaching hospitals. A way that without this Western intellectual enterprise, we would not have an airplane or a car. Number one, that's debatable. We don't know what we'd have, do we? Because it did happen. It happened, and the people who embraced it colonized the world and controlled the world for centuries. How do we know, without Western philosophy, whether people would have not just been to the moon, but would have colonized other planets by now? We don't know that. The only reason that we believe it's that way is just our own bigotry. So, one thing about being truly philosophical is that the same saw that Western philosophy claims you're supposed to use to cut off every branch you're sitting on and then start over needs to be willing to cut its own branches also and prune itself back. And if it doesn't do that, then it has devolved into systems of localized religious dogmatism, into a system of that, just like the criticisms leveled at the caricature of pre-Western philosophical society's mindsets. And notice I said the caricatures of them. There is a notion that things are getting more and more improved, more sophisticated, more intelligent as time goes along, and that it always has. That takes a lot of faith to accept that, having not lived back then, any of those back then. You know, the amount of time that we've been keeping track of stuff, the amount that we've been keeping track of is minuscule. Think of what all happens around this world during a year. We have centuries where we don't have any written anything. There's nothing online that people put online back then. Right? There's nothing, I mean, the stuff that we claim to know about history is probably propaganda. It's probably about all we have. If we have any written records, it's riddled with propaganda. People that are conquered are deemed reptilian. And that's not even, we haven't grown beyond that. That may be always the way it's been. And some of the people that are conquered, whose societies are burned to the ground by violent morons, might very well have had some very sophisticated record keeping of some really thoughtful intellectual and technological activities. How would we know? It's gone. We do know many civilizations were burned to the ground. But we don't know what was there when it was burning. A bunch of illiterate warmongers could have burned libraries that we don't have. We need to take all the way to the core of our intellectual being and our existential being a sense of intellectual humility about any of the narratives that we have. Because if we start taking our own myth seriously, then all of those cultures that we deem primitive, we are no different than they, in so much as they didn't believe that other cultures could be valid or superior. So it's an amazing coincidence to have our intellectual enterprise deemed the only one that's produced this, that, or the other thing. In point of fact, these people that we're looking at, these pre-Socratics blending into the Socratic era and then going from the Greeks to the Romans, and from the Roman history right through into Christian history, and moving into the Middle Ages and into the Enlightenment, Renaissance, Reformation, whatever, into the Industrial Revolution, into stuff we all know about, right up to now, we have this notion that we came up with all of that. And the Greeks get credited with a lot of stuff. And even though we have the literature available, an honest look at the literature associated with other major people groups would show that there's not as much originality in the Western enterprise as what we would love to brag that there is. The notions of these pre-Socratic thinkers and of Plato and Socrates, many of the things that they're saying were being said earlier in India. And I don't know why we don't credit India with those kinds of things. Not only that, some of the things that are written that are dated to before the pre-Socratics in India, it has taken us until your lifetimes to start seeing them based on our research in quantum physics and particle physics. Things that were already being said in antiquity in India. Not only that, we make bold, proud statements about the legacy of Pythagoras. And Pythagoras probably got his introduction to mathematical relationships from Northern Africa, from Egyptians. And the Egyptians were probably connected with the Vedic thinkers in India and everywhere between all along. We don't know what the sub-Saharan part of the African continent yielded intellectually, because the same civilizations, the same civilization calling itself the Western tradition, is the people grouping from which much of Southern Africa was plagued throughout the last couple thousand years with all kinds of abuse and exploitation and colonization from Western Europeans. That's we're not done with that now. That's still going on, and it was necessary. Western Europeans, I think, considered it necessary to dehumanize people that they were taking things from, to regard them as not the same species as themselves, as somehow negligible, like when you and I spray for ants when they're in the counter in the kitchen. And so if they were to come upon some sort of trove of intellectual prowess, it would be necessary to destroy that or to commandeer and relabel that in order to make their narrative palatable to civilized people back home and even in their own expeditions, even to themselves. I still haven't seen what will be coming out of the Timbuktu collection, but there's been some older African literature, many, many volumes, many, 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 many volumes of maybe antique African writing in the Timbuktu collection that has not been translated yet and made available. But there's people working on it, and it's a possibility that we may find some things that would cause us to have to rework much of our narrative. I don't know what kind of fancy political dancing may be employed by sort of right-wing European types today to downplay that, but I guarantee you, you'll see the efforts to. But I suspect that since there were sophisticated and elegant kingdoms in sub-Saharan Africa that have been just denied and even had their archaeological evidence destroyed intentionally to cover that up, that some we may be finding in the next few decades that the whole narrative is incorrect out of bigotry. So please know that the pedestal that the Western philosophy finds itself on and all the obeisance that's paid to it might not actually be merited. And I like to, you know, I want you to keep that in mind. Yes, sir.
So aside from exploiting like, the resources of the countries that the Western Europeans colonized and so forth, why do you think they found it necessary to destroy, you know, the very core of the people? Because in South America, they went through the Mayans, the Aztecs, they burned everything, all their records.
Yes, they have to dehumanize people that they're going to abuse because they still have a part of them that would tear themselves up even in person. If you can't dehumanize the one that you're screwing, then it hurts you even inside too much because your own mirror neurons, your own empathetic brain function, which you can't complete. The people that did this weren't like all psychopaths. They were all people like you and me. But it was fashionable and profitable and kind of seemed necessary, and there were societal institutions that scooted them along and belief structures that made it seem like a good idea to them. But there's this cognitive dissonance. But all of the sort of societal cultural pressure to go along with these institutions would also be accompanied by a narrative that these weren't actually people, like real people. These are like rodents. The same thing in the United States with Native Americans. They did not see Native Americans as like the same species, the kind of animals. And let's be honest, what's a species? What's it mean to be the same species? Today we're saying that race is not a fact. But that's a double-edged sword. Some of the people that are saying that because they're bigots and they want to discount what a people group needs to accomplish to stop getting abused. You know what I'm saying? And then other people are saying it because they're saying stop privileging yourself is not even a real construct. So who do we... It's still a construct. Human beings made it up. So is species.
It just baffles me that they didn't have in the world and have that mentality when they actually encounter people who are better sophisticated. Say they travel to Cambodia, Angkor Wat is a beautiful place.
Sure. With religious or mythical narratives that say that they were empowered by Satan, you know, or, I mean, it can be that extreme to say, well, of course, you know, their master is also a brilliant craftsman, you know. They make all that.
Secondly, I'm baffled by the fact that all of the, you know, colonization by the Europeans was in the name of Christ and Catholicism.
Yeah. Well, yes, it was in the name of Christ. It was Christianity that did it, but it wasn't the philosophy or example or teachings of Jesus. Those are almost not overlapping. If you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, just forget everything you've ever heard in a sermon or read in someone's commentary book or, you know, whatever your Bible teacher said, just put it on the shelf, you know, respectfully and come back to it. But just read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John like you brought nothing to it. I propose that what you'll probably find is that Jesus spent the whole 3 years with these guys. And he was advocating a certain way to do things. They were resisting him the whole time. They never stopped resisting him, even to the Last Supper and crucifixion. And then he died and was taken to heaven after, you know, the appearance and all of that. And then they set up an enterprise that was exactly what they had been trying to set up, but they couldn't do when he was there. I mean, that's plainly what it says in the Gospels. It says in the Gospels, Jesus showed them over and over and over. He says in the last part of Mark 10, he says, you know, you guys are always talking about this organizational hierarchy thing, like who's in where in the pecking order. And he says, that's how it gets done in this world. The worldly way of doing things is you have somebody in charge of someone else and the crap rolls downhill, you know, for the most part. He's saying, you abuse the people under you, and then they give orders, and you have to do it. And it's set up like top down. And you can look it up yourself in Mark 10 and see how he said it more elegantly than I'm, you know, messing it up to say. But in essence, he said, "But that's against my way. We're not going to do that way. I'm against that. And what we're doing here has nothing to do with that." And it's kind of like stop vying for who's going to be in charge. There's nothing to be in charge of. We're going to have nobody in charge. That's an absurdity in this. Nobody's in charge. There's no organization. Stop it. So you read that there. And then you see him, they're on the way to the Last Supper in the story of going before he gets killed. They're having an argument on the way. You know, and it's not the first time. And it's about who's going to hold a higher office in the cabinet after the election. Because they really picture still, no matter what he says, that he is going to be the Trump. And they want in a cabinet. And they're arguing about who gets to be the vice and who gets to be the Secretary of State. I don't want to sit on your left, I want to sit on your right. See, the people that sat in the king's court on the left and in the right, that was this, you know, vice president and, you know, like chief of staff or whatever. That's all that was. They were looking to set up themselves, or in a corporation, get the CEO, the CFO, and the COO, or whatever. they were asking about who gets that and saying, I should have it because I'm better than you, or I have these skill sets. You should see my resume. Check me on LinkedIn. And so he sees that they're doing this horse manure, and then they get in, and they've got crap all over their feet from the street, because the street was a place where urine and feces, animal and human alike, and mud and spit and snot bedpan emptying out the windows from the second floor right out into the street, and menstrual rags and diapers. The street was the sewer for people and animals, and they walked through it, and it was always like there's just been rain and you're out on the back 40 where there's thick. It was always filled, like up into their shins. Just wait, that was to go through the street in a city. So when they would come in someplace, that's how it is, and they're trying to have food. So they hired people, typically, that were servant class people, untouchables, dirty people, slaves, to clean up their feet, because that's the dirtiest part of them. To this day, there are still people that are traditional Arabs that if you do this with the bottom of your foot, that's like dropping your pants and spreading your cheeks. That's the dirtiest thing you can do. It's a hangover, for, you know, holdover from that kind of thing. When George Bush Jr. had somebody throw a shoe at him, that was a shoe. I mean, that's like throwing toilet paper at somebody. It's nasty. So that's how you really diss somebody. So there was supposed to be somebody to do that. Well, here's these guys that have just been arguing about who should even deserves to be in the highest ranking seat in the cabinet. Sitting there like, somebody really needs to take care of this. And they're kind of looking over, well, he's the youngest. Well, he's the stupidest. Well, he's the one that Jesus never picks to go with him when it's just a couple of us going. He's not even Jewish. He ought to do it, you know. They had all these things about why somebody ought to do it that were ethnic, or, you know, his dad is a banker or something, you know, whatever it is. Well, I'm not going to do it. I mean, I've got more in the bank than all these guys put together. I'm not doing it. So they sat there until Jesus did it. And then he said to them, don't you understand that the essence of what we're doing here, what I've been trying to teach you all this time, is that you should be willing to consider it an honor to wash feet or wipe butts or anything else. It's about humility. That's my kingdom. And you're not willing to do that. And then we skip ahead to the verses that you always hear when they ordain deacons. Today, in our church, and in all the churches that are ordained deacons. Well, in Acts, there arose a murmuring, you know, among the believers. The Greek were saying that the believers in Jerusalem were neglecting their widows in the daily service of food. And they're going, yeah, they're saying that about us, and I guess it's true. These guys, they can't get their first, they're not getting any food. And this one, they were living communal, like Marxist. They had put all their resources together, and it was from everyone according to their ability and to everyone according to their need. Acts 2:44. They were together always, and they had all things in common. Period. So now fasten your seatbelt for this statement. They said, you know, it really wouldn't be appropriate for us, to take time away from ministering the word to wait on tables. So let us take, and then we have the verses where we start reading during the ordination service. Do you hear what I said? They said, oh, it wouldn't be wouldn't be decent. And the King James says it wouldn't be meet. You know, it doesn't match up. For us to wait on tables, we should be, you know, doing our Bible studies. So how much had they learned? And all through the book of Acts and the rest of the New Testament, there's no change. And then it kind of became the Catholic Church. Well, that definitely didn't change. And then we have the Protestant Reformation. That didn't change it either. The program isn't what Jesus had going. Church became just another tool that the government sometimes finds really convenient. Today we find it convenient. I mean, who elects the clowns that hijack religious narrative? They can be the least religious people in our land. They can be people who don't even believe in God, but they certainly do it around election time. You know, people are Ten Commandments, got to put them up in the, and let's get rid of those non-Christian religions. It hasn't changed at all. So how they could use that to go exploit people's natural resources? That's what they do when a corporation goes in now and takes the oil from another country. Or whatever resources we want, whatever mineral rights, the De Beers Diamond Cartel. All the natural resources that we suck out of South America, that we suck out of Sub-Saharan Africa to this day. Yes? Do I think there will be a part of Christianity?
Yeah, like a denomination.
Shoot, I think we have to rename this. They never said, Jesus was already back up. Anyone came up with the word Christian. That was just something that came, the people named the movement later on. Jesus wasn't a Christian. And I don't know if he would be a Christian today if he just came here and got an apartment and a job. I don't know if he actually, I don't think people would, I don't know if they'd want him in the church. He'd probably be a really hard person to have in your church. He keeps messing up all the furniture in the lobby.
Have you ever read Guns, Germs, Steel by Jerry Diamond?
Uh-huh. Yes. Have you seen the documentary that goes with it? That's worth your time, because he's actually the one that's worth your time. Point made. The sort of saying that it's not our government going and taking people over, but it's our corporations, and it's the same corporations that the people in the government and the corporations are interchangeable. It's still just colonization. It's still colonization. They go in and they talk to the leaders and they say, "We'll give you $1 million if you just cause this law to come about so that we have your whatever mineral rights." And then we'll give your country another million, but you get $1 million of your own. They go, "Oh, fine." If they say, "Get out," Then they kill them, and they place a puppet that is willing to do it for some front pocket change by their all over South America, all over Africa, and then they just destroy a country. It would be very hard to run what we have going here in the United States for the last 100 years without doing that. How are you going to have hundreds of times the consumption per person that the rest of the world has if you don't do that?
That presents a problem even for common consumers. Like, basically, we're going to marry someone. I'm going to marry this girl. I'm going to buy her a ring. Well, where did that diamond come from?
Well, let me ask you something really serious about any of you that are planning an engagement. Do you know what the difference is atomically between cubic zirconium and a diamond with a laser inscription from the De Beers cartel? Do you know what the difference is? Atomically, there is no difference. It's a complete farce. It's crap. It's selling you something that they pulled out of the ground that you can make one that's got less flaws for $15 at Mervyn's, or Target. Yeah, I mean, we don't have Mervyn's anymore, do we? That's been gone for a little while. They used Kohl's. The Mervyn's even became Kohl's in that book. The only thing, if you look at it under the right microscope, the only thing you're going to find is that it's actually more perfect when it gets manufactured. There's nothing there but BS. So, I mean, there's my answer as a consumer. I'm sure not going to go. So makes the same sparkle. Nobody can tell without a microscope. Nobody on earth. Not a gemologist. Nobody could tell. Because the atoms are identical. So, we need to maintain humility about what we've actually accomplished in our and the people that were in their tradition. Now, I don't care where you come from. Your people could come from South America or Africa or Iran or wherever, or from Sweden or from Holland or from England or wherever you come from. You're here going to school, availing yourself of the Western intellectual tradition. Now, having said that, let me balance that. It probably doesn't really matter which tradition you study in far enough and think honestly in for enough organized years. It's the same reality that's getting studied for the moment, you know, the common reality that you're going to see going and looking at nature or thinking about logic, you're going to come to very similar things. How in the heck else did Vedic writers and the people who generated the Upanishads in India, century upon century ago, how do they get to the same thing that we get to at CERN and Los Alamos? I mean, you come to the same kind of stuff. And here's what you come to. You come to a point where there's nowhere else to go without having to, if you're going to be honest, say, and then, geez, and then we don't know. And okay, we go our reason down to the very small, or we reason to the very fast, or we reason to the very large, or we reason to the very cold. We go outside sort of the regular parameters and get better microscopes and get better time-lapse cameras or what you know, or high-speed cam, whatever it is that we have to have. You get better centrifuges, you get better particle accelerators, and you still come down to, and we still don't know. We still don't have the answer. The questions are the same thing that the people without any of these instruments and without all these resources and without the shoulders to stand on, they came to the same questions that we're left with after all these thousands of years. The real problem, though, is with people who don't ask the questions. That's where you come out with a problem. And you can be somebody who knows every single thing that Western civilization has amassed. You could be a person with 5 PhDs in astrophysics and engineering and biology and chemistry and philosophy. You could have it all. And then you could say, just like any narrow-minded bigot, you could simply say, and this is all the facts. You know, and if anything doesn't match up with this, then it must be wrong. And then you got nothing. You've also stopped asking questions. Soon as you get to the point where you start getting like orthodox about things and you start saying this is what's reality instead of saying, hey, this is a really extensive house of cards that we've built, and it's interesting that it hangs together, but there's probably completely other ways to look at it. And they're probably actually just as arguable. Because when you look underneath them, you find that they're based on the same question. And they prove just as much. Nothing. They prove nothing. Now, I would be reluctant to say that before spending a lot of years trying to get at clear to the end of those things and trying to read all the way to where there's no more to read and trying to actually take some tiny little strands of mathematics and follow them all the way to where that's all as far as anyone can go. And then say, did I get to it? No, I didn't. Not in psychology, not in physics, not in math. not in biology, not in philosophy. We're still left with, I mean, the bottom line is we should be humbled by the staggering complexity of things. We have become enamored in Western tradition right now with some epistemological like commandments that aren't justified. They don't stand on anything at all. For instance, Occam's razor. William of Occam proposed that when we're looking at having to choose between two possible explanations that have been proposed for something, or two models, we pick the one that's the simplest. Parsimony. Do I have some science majors here that know about parsimony and Occam's razor? Who here has ever heard of Occam's razor? Now, if we were honest, though, and we still use it, I mean, I'm reading, trying to stay on the frontier of certain aspects of neuroscience, of neuropsychology. And we have some amazing new tools that we use in neuropsychology right now. Tremendous what we can do. Tremendous how limited they are, too, and how the questions mostly still remain. They just get finer and finer and finer, but then they're the same questions at the end of the day. However, people still say we're going to choose this explanation because of parsimony. They say that in evolutionary science. They say that in evolutionary psychology. You psych majors have been exposed to evolutionary psychology. And they have to refer all the time to Occam's razor, to parsimony, choosing between this explanation instead of this because this is so much simpler. But then, when we actually do get things figured out, well, let's just take particle physics. If you insisted from Newton's day forward that people keep sticking to parsimony, would you have ended up with string theory or with the whole particle zoo that we have now? Not a chance. It's so convoluted and unlikely, it's ridiculous. Up quarks and down quarks. Come on. Gluons, muons. There's nothing parsimonious about it. Is a theory of relativity parsimonious? Are you kidding me? Curving space-time and all the workarounds that are in there, it's not parsimonious. In fact, it's unworkable according to common sense. Also defensible according to what we can observe, but it's not parsimonious. Parsimony is something we insist on to defend what we have right now until something forces us, or we die, and the younger generation that never would buy our crap finally says, now let's look at another way of looking at that. And then they start getting old and using arguments like parsimony to justify their position. The notion of the fact that there even is such a thing as a species. Who says there's a species? Where does that get written? We made that up. And we're using it today, or very recently have, to justify which creatures we can exploit and abuse, and which ones we can't. Well, that's part of this species, and they've got members, representatives of that species that have been shown to have this kind of brain function. We've got, right now, there's species of octopus that you're allowed to abuse and cut apart and attach things to their neurons and everything while they're still awake, and there's others that you can't use for research because they're not the same species, and this species has been shown has sentience or something. This is a made-up category. Things are not actually simple. They're staggeringly complex, and I believe that one really valuable way we could do some neuropsychology would be to hook somebody up and find out what kind of pleasure reward they're getting for closing it and making a decision and moving on, you know, when you finally can can go, ah, I made a decision on that. This is what I believe on that. Now I move it. Because I think that when we're in home, when it's ambiguous, that we've got cortisol and some adrenaline, and we're kind of competitive about it. And I'm not sure. I don't know what side to get on. I don't know which way to go. And instead of saying, ah, cool, I love that this is hard to decide between. No, I think there's something in us that automatically, if we can't come to a decision, is painful to us. It's just we're punished inside. Got to decide. Who are you going to vote for? Who are you for? Who's in the Super Bowl? Well, who are you for? I'm for, I hope that everybody forgets to come and hold the stupid thing, you know? Who are you for in this election? You know, we got to make, you got to pick a side, you know, vote for the list of two evils. And I say, I don't have to. What do you mean? I have to. I have to decide. I have to decide who I'm going to put. I got to decide. No, I'll decide when I get you voting. I'm not going to vote for that. I don't approve of either of those. No, you have to decide. Well, you know, I don't like the choices. So I'm gonna, no, you have to. You have to. I voted. Well, no, I'm sorry, but I don't feel good about either way, so I'm not going to play. You think about if you hope. So that they bring a bus, the people get off with the basketball uniform from some school besides PUC, and they go in the gym, and PUC puts on all the same color of short pants, and they get up there, and then they play basketball. And you go down there, you're a PUC student, you've never heard of this other stupid school, and you go, well, see, who do I want to make the most points? You go, you look at the other folk, and you go, they look kind of sad. I would probably make them feel better if they had 4 points. Our people are looking kind of arrogant and they're trash talking and everything. Kind of hope those other people. You mean to say that out loud when you're in the gym? I'm kind of hoping Maritime takes this one. Well, how simple-minded is it that just because this is a school you go to, you vote for them? I mean, you could look at it like an intelligent person and go, they look kind of discouraged. I heard one of the team members lost their mom, you know, over the Christmas break. And I like to have them. They probably feel better if they got this. Plus, they're away from home. It'd be kind of kind to help hope the other people get a good feeling, you know. Not always root for your own. You have a sophisticated thing. Yeah, that's what's going on down there when they have sitting in the folding chairs and bleachers, right? That's what people are doing. Now, we want this binary nonsense. It's like people asking me that they have had, fortunately, you know, there's some accountability with people all carrying cell phones. So if authority figures are abusing people and you can catch footage of that, you know, you get a bunch of white cops that are beating the crap out of some black guy who's driving his car. Or the one where some black guy is running away from an officer because he votes no on going to jail that day. He probably has a warrant for some failure to appear for a traffic ticket or something. And the cop shoots him in the back when he's, 30 feet away or something. He's pop, pop, and the guy drops. But there was another guy taking a picture with a phone, you know, just outside the park across the street. Each time it comes up, people say, you know, you were a cop. So look at the video and tell me about, not that case, but, you know, look at the video. You got like 21 seconds of footage, and there's a big scuffle and everything, and then pop, pop. And then I look at it, and they go, tell me, what happened there? I go, I can't tell from the video. What do you mean you can't tell? Well, I can't. There's not enough information. I mean, it's just another case of, I said, well, it might be. There's certainly a lot of that going on, but I can't tell from you. You got to decide. People are, it's like, you're not, you're a bigot, or you've decided, you know, this case.
I have a question. So, in the cases where it's blatantly wrong with the cop shot the person, you know, why is it that the cop only gets, like, you know, a week of, like, paid leave, and then he gets to come back to his job instead of, like...
Well, sometimes he goes to prison. Yeah, I mean, you can Google it. There's people who go to prison for a long, long time. However, but I've seen policemen that I've worked with arrested for being too violent. And they never get to be cops again, and they go to prison. I've watched it happen. I've been in the room when they get hooked up. Why does it usually not happen that way? Because people are bigots. There's really no other. It's weighted unfairly. You know, it's not. I don't really consider it very intelligently debatable that it's unfair. That it's lethally unfair in our country right now. I mean, I've worked with fellow officers, black officers, that they're going to be like going to San Francisco for the night, and they live in Contra Costa County, and they leave their gun at home because they're so afraid that they're going to get pulled over by a cop of any color when they're going on the way. And they're afraid that if somebody says, hey, he's got a gun, that they're not giving you a chance to take out the badge and say, yeah, I'm also a cop. Because every other person who has a gun says, I'm a cop. And then they reach in, go, let me show you, and take out the other gun and shoot you. So people are, doesn't get it to say it. You got to have that badge out there, and then you got to make sure it's not fake on the radio. In the meantime, you got a finger on the trigger on your head, and so they're scared to death. So, I mean, they'd rather take their chances, even though there's really bad people that they've put in jail with their brothers and sisters out there wanting to get them, and they're going, well, I'd rather take my chances with the bad people than fellow officers when I'm not in uniform. It's bad. So, but that's just another example. It's just a continuation of the same abusive narrative from, like, going and exploiting the resources in Africa. You've got European people who have generations of being taught that these other kind of people aren't really fully human. They've been dehumanized. It's like some old beer-drinking, Navy-tattooed, 80-year-old something guy who was alive during World War II that can't get it out of his head that Japanese people are his enemy. When they never were. Because that's the narrative that got put. But this is something that's been for centuries that Western Europeans have been abusing people in sub-Saharan Africa. So, I mean, we'll probably discover that there's ways that it even gets passed genetically, so that if you took some white baby and adopted them from the hospital into a black family, they probably still have some of it epigenetically built in somehow. I will probably find that. And it goes the other way around, too. I mean, people want to know how come black people have a chip on their shoulder, and you go down into Parchester Village, some whitey like me goes in Parchester Village in the middle of the night on Friday night, and you think people are defensive when they see me down there, and they find out I didn't just come across the San Rafael Bridge to buy some Coke and go back home, that I'm just down there just hanging. It's like everybody's blood pressure goes up. Why? I would not hurt anybody there. If I was going to do anything, I would just try to find somebody to go, sit and have dinner with. But they don't know that. So they have built-in stuff because it's too dangerous not to. Right? And so then we talk about this, or don't, elephant in the room stuff. And we talk, we make it the other way, like logic, not race. Make it a black and white issue. And then we get people of mixed race, and people just lose their stuff. Everyone's going, I don't know what they are. It's just stupidity piled on stupidity, piled on meanness, and it's just a pig mess. We can't afford to be non-philosophical about these issues, because if all we rely on is our superstitious crap that we've inherited from generation to generation, we have no hope of it ever even improving a little. So that's one of the reasons we are doing this. It's just that by doing this, we could get to feeling all special because we're doing it and think it's better than the way other people did it, say, in the wise elders of the village in some region of sub-Saharan Africa. They've talked about a lot of the same things. I don't think it's true that it's limited to the Western intellectual enterprise. I think we meet with people in places where they build out of grasses and stuff their houses, and you talk to the wise people, and their thoughts are sometimes more sophisticated than the people that are chairing philosophy departments. they come to stuff without all the ramp up to it, you know, and they've thought in ways that go even beyond. It's like, whoa, what did you just say? So when we get arrogant, we get stupid. And right now, you get people who, even within, with all that we have, it's just like they don't read Socrates. It's the same thing like Christians do with Jesus, or don't do with Jesus, and why modern philosophers can be just stupid, even though they have people like Plato who were saying things that if they'd read that they and remember, they wouldn't have to be so stupid. Does that make sense? So we go from this whole Greek thing, and the Roman Empire, this is not a history class, and I'm not going to take you into detail about how each empire rose and fell and what philosophy had to do with it, but for one reason or another, when the Roman Empire was the dominant force in Western Europe, and even some in some cases beyond, there was this notion that they were continuing the Greek legacy, that they were still in the Greek intellectual tradition. And Roman philosophers, some of them were. A few of them were, Cicero and the like. Yes? Sure. Well, go ahead. We don't have to move on. Keep going. Yeah, let's go with it. They prayed and got killed. Right. About theism or deism?
Deism.
That's interesting, and it's on our agenda. The idea that the Seventh-day Adventists use to describe how they can reckon that with the atheist maker question. Remember the atheist maker question? How can there be a God? It's all powerful, can do anything. All-knowing, so it's not like he didn't know, but he had his mind on it. He is everywhere. And I'm sorry for the use of the word he. I don't know what else to say. It seems derogatory, but she, he. The notion of some sort of genitals on the creator is absurd. It's beyond us. But the notion that God is also infinitely loving, more loving than we could be, more loving than our tenderest affection for our child, you know, the best of parents. And then some poor child is born to abuse and is abused all along until they tragically die, you know, before they reach their teens. Where, you know, how do you reckon that? So I refer to that as the atheist maker question. Now, how do Adventists answer that? And that's not the only answer, of course, but I mean, it's important for us to consider. You've heard the term the Great Controversy, which is abbreviated the Great Controversy between God and Satan, or Christ and Satan. And in that, we're told that God cares so much that we're free, that God wouldn't just force the will of these people who are acting on hurting someone else like that, even though they're restricting other people's freedom. God established the universe in a way that people were not only free, but by default, they were good, and they were kind and compassionate. compassionate and empathetic. And we find that we're actually wired to be empathetic and concerned, like to put ourselves in another person's shoes and evaluate what we do. If anyone wants to pursue that further, if you're like one of, especially you psych types, Donald Pfaff, the neuropsychology of altruism, I think, Donald Pfaff, if you have any interest in actually looking at the neuroscience, and he actually develops what he calls the altruistic brain theory, I think. Let's pretend that that I've got a screw loose and I start digging holes in my basement. I dig down a good long ways into my own basement, you know, sledgehammer to break apart the foundation a little bit, and I start digging a hole. And I keep digging and digging. I make trips to Home Depot and come back and I weld down there. Pretty soon I come up with an arrangement down in way underneath my house. And then I, on the way home from class tonight, I see a co-ed that's jogging, you know, just like 12 years younger than my own daughter. And I go, oh, that's God's will that I'm with her. So I pull over in my car and say, hey, you know, God told me we belong together. And she's like, I'm out. Boom, jump on the cell phone, you know, when I drive on. So, but I'm not satisfied. I talk to God about it, and at least I think I am, and then we concoct a plan. And so the next night, I'm there at the same time, and she's jogging, hasn't learned her lesson, you know. And I've got a handkerchief and some chloroform to help me, you know, and maybe some zip ties. And so she ends up going home in my trunk. And then when she comes to, she's down in the little area I've made under my basement. So I go down under there, and I say, would you like something to eat? I don't want something to eat. You want some soda or something? You know, what kind of get you? Nothing. You can get me out of here. You sick nothing. Get out of here. And say, you know, well, let me know when you're hungry or thirsty, because all you got to do is just give me a little kiss through the bars, and then I'll give you a glass of water. And so I keep her down there until the Stockholm Syndrome does its job, and she starts identifying me as her provider, you know, sort of the god of her new universe, and experiences even bonding with me and likes me, thinks that she likes me. But people do this. When you kidnap them, if you keep them and you sort of, even if you abuse them, you still just make sure they don't starve to death on you. And then and looking for every shard of hope, they actually come to identify with you in a positive way. It's known as the Stockholm Syndrome. So let's say that happens. So eventually, when I come down the ladder into the hole in the basement floor and say hi, she's glad to see me. She wants to hug me and kiss me. Is that love, what she has for me? Is that love? Do I love her? I mean, so she gets to the point where I know she really cares for me. I let her out. She can live up in the house. But I know she's going to be loyal because she's completely not just fooling me, but she's really affectionate to me. Has she fallen in love with me? No, she's sick. And I made her sick. Because love requires freedom. Doesn't it? If it doesn't come from freedom, it's not love. So if it's true that the universe is grounded, is founded, is written on the principle that the highest value, the where you start, because you can argue that any value is just as valuable as another, but if you say the given, the way God wrote the universe, is love, then that demands freedom. That means freedom to come and go and freedom to say up yours from any of his creatures. He can make them, but then if they say, but I don't like your program, then, okay, they don't like my program. So that's actually the starting point, really, really appreciating the, at least for sake of discussion, at least going, okay, I get that. Then you can go on and say, why would God allow this terrible scenario, all these terrible scenarios here in the world. Well, then, according to the Great Controversy narrative, the notion is that one of God's creatures, it originated in the mind of one of the creatures, that I got a better plan. And that plan is, now can I put a bookmark there? Would I just like pop, press pause? And I want to say, let's picture that we're on Highway 80, okay? I'm in my car, and I'm trying to go to Sacramento. And I'm driving along, and I'm really in everybody's business all the way there. I'm trying to like tell everybody about their lane position, and I'm leaning out the window, and I'm trying to like, I'm just trying to say, call me. You know, I put a sticker in the window with my cell phone number, and I'm holding it. And I go, hey, dude, you should get over in this lane. And I'm really focused on how everyone else is driving. I say, hey, you should slow down. Hey, slow down, man. And I am so focused on everything. I'm kind of wanting to almost climb over and grab steering wheels in other cars. You know, motorcycle goes by, and I want to get a hold of his throttle. And this is just not workable. I need to just handle my own stuff when I'm in the car, right? Whose car should I drive on Highway 80? Not another motorist. I should handle my own business, right? I should keep my nose in my own business in normal circumstances. And then, let's pretend it's Christmas time and everyone gives you gifts. You know, your family comes to see you and everything, and you open up a gift, and it's someone went out and they bought you clothes. Somebody who just isn't where you are tried to buy you clothes. They buy you some bogus tie or socks or something. You're going, no. Oh, they found out your size and they dared to pick out a pair of shoes for you. Your uncle, he bought you shoes. Where's your uncle to buy you shoes? You have an uncle? Would you like him to buy you a pair of shoes? Here's some shoes. Put them on. They are your size, aren't they? Oh, yeah. Right? But why not? How many times at Christmas does everyone get together, they all spend hundreds of dollars, and you go, yeah, that's all crap. Does that ever happen? You go, oh, thank you. Wonder how long I have to keep this before I can put this in the Dorcas. Right? But let's just say, instead, you each took the money that you had, that you were going to buy crap that no one else wants to, with very few exceptions. You spend your $500 on gifts or whatever from Thanksgiving onward, and you take the $500 and you go, what would I get with $500? Probably more than what I got other people spending their little part of $500. You know, you get to the, like, Avon perfume and stuff. You know, I remember when I was a kid, all the time, they give like some aftershave that smells like a combination of like hand cream and Brute or something, and it's in like a little container that's shaped like a Volkswagen bus. You know, what am I going to do with that? I wouldn't wear that. I wouldn't put that on the dog. But you know, you get a brush set that's also got some little valve on it that lets the bubble bath out. Take a bubble bath. I take a shower. You know, you get all this crap and you put it on your dresser after Christmas. You're going, well, someone did get me some candy. I'll eat that, and then we're good, and the rest is sweeping into the trash. But if all the money they spent on all that crap for me, if I just had the money, I'll just go, and I know what to get me, right? You know what to get you. You're not going to take $500 and come home and say, oh, man, how come I don't know what I want? You know darn well how to spend $500 or $1,000 or $1,500. And it will go a lot, and then it's like everybody gets together and says, hey, look what I bought for myself. Hey, cool, look what I bought for myself. Let's eat. You know? And it's kind of like someone says, well, that kind of messes up Christmas. Yeah, but it doesn't mess up the 26th. when you're looking at, I don't have a bunch of crap. And I didn't just spend all this money and I got nothing to show for it. And they didn't even honestly like it. They're like, and he doesn't know what I like. Yeah? So this argument got made not about Christmas and about driving the car on Highway 80, but about doing life. How about you handle yours, and I'll handle mine. And I'll look out for me, and you'll look out for you, and we'll try to like negotiate the differences. You know, when you want the same thing I do, then we'll see, you know, may the best competitor win. And sin was born. Because it's not all about Highway 80 and Christmas. Next time you just really want a massage, go ahead. Give yourself a great one. And you know what? No sense in spending any part of your life pursuing some sort of... there's no end to trouble when you think your sexuality has to involve other people. Come on. You know, you got you and you got you and that's that, right? This is enough. There's something missing there. There's just something missing. You just can't quite work the knots out of your own back, you know, like a good masseuse can. You need someone else to help you. My grandmother, my mom's mom, told me that she had a dream one night, and she dreamed that she died. And she found herself having gone to hell. I can't picture my grandma Milicic in hell, but she was in hell. And she didn't even go before St. Peter or anything, you know, not even like negotiating. It's just, hey, you're in hell. And so they said, welcome to hell. Oh, this is bad. They walk her in and go, here, get in there. Open the door. Toss her in, close the door, and she goes in like, and she looks, and there's this massive banquet table. It's just like, it's thousands of miles long, and it's like everything at the wildest, like Las Vegas Sunday morning brunch buffet that you could ever think of, like times a million, and it's like everything is everywhere. It's like, and so you don't even have to get up, it's all in, right in the middle of the table there, and gold plates and everything, and it's every kind of fruit and vegetable and meat and sauce and dessert, and there's just nothing that's not there. She's never even seen some of the things, the colors that didn't even exist in this life. And it smells amazing. And everybody sitting there is just in agony. And they've got these spoons and forks that are like 7 feet long, and they're like crazy glued to their hand and lower arm, and they're this food in them, they're spilling it everywhere, and they're drawing it back as far as they can, and they can't get to the end of the spoon and the end of the fork, and they can't get any food, and they're all sitting there like starving to death. There's even some people that are dead at the table from starving to death. And she's going, man, this is not what it seemed. So she sits down and finds that one of these things has been attached to her hand, and she's going, oh, look at that, I want some of that. She can't get it. And just as she's starting to get frustrated, bam, the door comes open, and the person that put her in there said, mistake. Come on, old lady. Took her out, said, no, you're supposed to go to heaven. She gets put on an elevator. It's on this elevator super fast. And then, okay, welcome to heaven. Open the door, and it looks like the same room, except different people. And they still have this stupid thing glued to their arm. And everyone's happy and a little bit too well fed. And there's a place for her at the table, and she goes and sits down, and everybody's getting food and feeding the person across the table and eating from the person across the table, and everybody is living in joy. So the notion, according to the great controversy, is that this plan was proposed. It's not entirely irrational on the face of it. I mean, give it a chance. We all have been. It's the last thing that we would call sin. We call sin little naughty things, you know, little things that acknowledge that we have bodies we live in or something, you know, saying potty words or something, you know, but we don't actually get at what sin is. This notion of I'm going to look out for me before you, that's sin. The rest of it is just sort of politeness, you know, and a lot of times, a lot of what we call sin, religiously, is like the kind of etiquettes that are put in place to keep the underclass people in their place. That's half of it. Even the whole notion of having don't say that word, vulgarity, that's just a way of saying don't talk like the poor people, like other races. Don't talk like people in the street, you know. Don't talk like people who sag their pants or whatever, you know. The unfortunate. We don't want our kids talking like the untouchables. That's all that is. Because you can have a good word for whatever it is that comes out your back end and a good word for coitus and everything. If you say that, you can say it in polite. Come on, don't say it the way these people say it. It's wrong to say it like they say it. They can't have a word. We decide the words. That's all that it is. It's a substitute for what real sin is. Real sin is, I want to compete for a limited resource and I want to try to get it instead of you having it. That's sin. So this person says, no, God, I think this is the way. And people are looking at it that are creatures and going, oh, well, that does. There's a certain logic to that. Remember the whole business of Christmas presents and Highway 80 and driving it, trying to get up into people's business driving their car? That's not a slam dunk. You got to think that through when it's a new idea. So God is saying, well, it won't lead to you being happy. It'll lead to misery and you know what it'll lead to? It'll lead to people ultimately amassing weapons and pointing them at each other across the whole world so that it's enough. So that if somebody decides, I've had enough of you, and I know it's going to kill me, but it's worth it to me, I'm going to set it off, and then it all starts going off. And it's enough so that even though we already have enough weaponry to make it so that there's not a living human being or anything else alive except maybe a cockroach and a couple of deviant rats. Everybody else is gone. We'll run for office on the platform that when we each automatically turn each other's entire territory into a concave glassy crater, that I will make it so we have enough more weapons than them so that even though they make our whole country a 30-foot deep crater, we're going to make theirs 90 feet deep when we're all dead. And that's enough. Oh, I like that. I'm voting for him. That's wisdom there. I mean, it'll get to the point where you hate that much that you will go to the store and buy a man. You'll go to the store and you'll buy a little girl and they'll have an auction for it. That's how God is saying it's a sick way to be. But it'll get to these kinds of things. They're going, no, I don't think so. I think it's a good thing. Everyone looks out for their own stuff, you know. And then we had a little politeness and a referee and all that, you know. No, God says it'll get to the point where it seems like a sport to put people locked into a cage and try to knock each other out with a concussion to see who wins prize money. What? No, it won't. Yeah, it will. Well, God, again, is faced with, is he going to force these people? There's not two universes. Uni means one. So it's like, well, I guess we're going to have to, you got to see what happens, don't you? Yeah, we want to see what happens. We want to test this. Okay, I guess we'll test it. So when the test is going, let's just say that I look at it like during my whole life and I pray, God, I don't want anybody's feelings to be hurt this year. And then I think about it and I say it again next year. And when I'm getting close to death, you know, I have my son carry on my ministry. God, please don't let people exploit each other and hurt their feelings. Let's have everything go smooth and sweet and kumbaya all of this year. And every year we pray that and we're all set. The cops are all respectful. You know, hiring is equal. Women can be CEOs. We got people of color that are regarded just the same way as if they're not of color. You know, everything's beautiful. because we're just praying it. You and me, we'll both pray it. But then the test isn't going, is it? It's not proven anything. How do you test it? That is the engine underneath, the logical engine underneath the Seventh-day Adventist model of the great controversy in our attempt to explain how there could actually be a God, like we say God is, and then we see all this hurt. That's how it gets reckoned. Do you think there's any weaknesses to the argument? Do you think there's any things where we could say, yeah, but if that's true, what about this thing? I think so. Well, I think because what we've done is we've taken something that is a conflict that, if conflict even is the same kind of thing in maybe infinite dimensions, and we're trying to describe it in some myth in four dimensions.
The more we pick up the issue, it seems to just support or validify deism.
What I just said it smacks as deism, doesn't it? If you don't let it run its course, how do you prove anything? Isn't that a little bit like God having to keep his hands off of it, or else we got someone crying foul and saying, well, what kind of experiment was that? You were mucking around with it the whole time. Now, I don't know how to reckon that with everyone praying that the Lord will do this and do the other thing. Which are we going to have? Well, again, it's not going to make sense in four dimensions. Because the logic of things in five dimensions is that a lot of things that we call mutually exclusive here, they exist exactly at the same time, off the flat land. And it doesn't translate, so we're going to say things that don't make good sense. And if we find that it's making perfect sense, we should know it doesn't actually apply to five dimensions. Now, that's not an argument to say make sure you're absurd enough or we'll know you're wrong. It is an argument, though, for vast humility, intellectual and theological humility. And not acting like somebody else is stupid to the degree that their theology disagrees with mine. You know, even if they're from some indigenous people group and they've explained the whole thing a little differently.
Does my question make sense, though? Because
yeah.
I'm sorry, but I'm stuck on my human suffering. That's just for my...
Yeah, and deism.
Jews were a God-fearing people. So despite all their, you know, issues in the Old Testament, just present day, they have the issue with Hitler, right? I'm sure they were all praying. So where was God when they were asking for a little deliverance there?
Well, if there's a God, God let that happen, right?
He did.
Why?
So today we have, not to attack prayer, but we have a very, you know, like flowery
Santa Claus prayer.
Thing going on.
Vending,
you know,
machine prayer.
Stickers, all these prayer, like promises. All
just pray. Prayer.
God is going to allow all those things, then how can we have faith in just little things like, you know, God, I'm struggling in school, so on and so forth. How do we put our faith in God, those little things, when he allows so much just unbelievable garbage to go on even today? You know?
How do you think? I don't know either. The important thing isn't the answer. The important thing is the question. The important thing is wrestling with it. When I have grappled with Kyler, I don't know who tapped. I don't remember who tapped. That doesn't matter. What matters is that we grappled. It doesn't even matter. I mean, we could grapple now. I don't know who would tap. But we wouldn't care. We say, well, let's grapple. It's not because I want to see him lose. I would just want the experience. Can your mind just want to grapple the issue? Or does it have to get settled? If it gets settled, it's expensive. You're going to lose something if you settle it. No, I think he does.
We like simple answers.
It would only make it worse if we cared more for one than the other. If I cared more for others than myself, and it happened to me, then I wouldn't be saying, why me? Right. One person gets ovarian cancer and they're gone when they're 13. The other person doesn't. How did that get sorted out? Some of you are both nice people. Yeah, right.
And like, for me, situations like it's all terrible, but sometimes something to me is like a lot of kids that was abused and then their mind is so messed up that they like, you know, are they even in a mental state? So pray for them. Like, they're not even their own advocate spiritually. You know what I mean? Like, different things. And it's like, would I have to come, like I worked in an orphanage with like handicapped kids where they were there because
but were you sure?
Yes. Because
how come they're orphans?
That's what I'm saying. It's like you have to like struggle with the knowing that there's
light. If you were not allowing yourself to ask these questions, would they go away? If you just said, no, it's wrong to ask that question, it's blasphemous to ask that question, would that make it go away and you'd say, I'm happy again? It's all settled because I'm not willing to ask the questions. So when we have thinkers during the Christian era that are saying, I'm doubting in order to protect my faith, this is where their hearts were and where their questions were, like the questions you two are asking. They were wrestling with those issues. And some philosophers decided that this was their proof that there wasn't a God. Because one of the expensive things about demanding that you think rationally is that you start putting two and two together. It's like you can find people who are just blissfully happy and singing campfire songs in Kumbaya, and you ask these questions, and they're going, oh, no, you have to just have faith. And then they sing a little louder, and you're going, I don't think I could do that for very many years. And that's one of the downsides of philosophy. But one of the upsides of philosophy, I think, is that you can get to the place where you don't need an answer. Because if you do get an answer, I don't care which question it's about. Not just God. How about your spouse? If you get an answer about your spouse, and what categories fall, you know, if you sew it up in your mind, then your marriage will be on thin ice. As soon as you decide, rather than continuing to ask, then you've now placed a box around that person that they have to stay in. Pretty soon, that's going to kill their love. And to continue to explore and to not ever think you fully understand and to let them be a living thing instead of a dead thing that will surprise you, you got a chance.
Do you think someone can be truly convicted of a belief without struggling with it first?
I'm sorry?
Do you think someone can be truly convicted of a belief without struggling?
Yes. I think they could. I think for some people, they're not inclined to struggle. I think when some people have huge epiphanies sometimes that are just bigger than all the other experiences. Something gets represented in their whole experiencing mechanism that makes everything else look fake. That makes everything else look dull and play-like. That one thing, nothing can compare to that experience that they've had, and then they can think about it, but there's nothing that can get over that. You know, they even can start to climb that high in terms of persuasiveness in their value system. And you think about people who have these, you know, like Paul on the road when he got struck blind, and you know, and he heard a voice and everything. It's like that was more real than the rest of his life. When somebody takes LSD, and they're immediately and permanently and irrevocably convinced that of a perspective that they never had before, and everything else is kind of like, well, you can say all that you want, but there's nothing that's loud enough for me to hear, you know, that would change my mind. Does that make sense? In some cases, they'd be, even if they would be willing to, it doesn't do anything. I am convinced that whatever I believe, I'm probably going to have to revise when I get more information. Any notion, I believe with my head that any notion of theology, later I'm going to come to a point where I look at it and go, oh, I hope people forget that I said that. It's so embarrassing. It was such a silly thing to say. But I can't find anything that convinces me that it's plausible that there's not a God. I just can't get over what to me seems like evidence. But I'm willing to discuss it, and I'm willing to say to a person who's an atheist, I accept the reality of what you're saying. You know, you say there's no God, and I hear you say, okay, by every definition that could even have been given you by another person, any theology that anyone's ever stated, what you're saying is probably true. But I don't believe that there isn't a God. It's just that I don't think that you and I have run into the right definition, because we couldn't. Our minds won't hold it. So how do I disagree with that, even though I believe in God? Yes. Deal with than if someone believed that God existed and was positive, or was okay with, or thought it was a good. I'm going to close this because I'm getting screaming angry. In other words, sometimes people that say I don't believe in God. If you talk to somebody and they say, tell me about yourself. I'm an atheist, and they lead with that. why do you start out by telling me something that you believe is false? There's a trillion things you could believe is false. You're telling me, okay, and I don't believe in unicorns. Now we know each other. Let's move along and deepen our relationship. You know, if there's no God, why would you make your whole deal in life that there's no God? Okay, there's no God. Now what? You're not even making a statement. You're not even telling me anything at all. You're trying to untell me something. Like, let me tell you who I disagree with. Really? That's how I'm going to get to know you, so know who you disagree with? This is a non-statement. So I usually think that when somebody says, I'm an atheist, I say, no, you're not. Agnostics? They just say, I have no idea. It could be. I've never really engaged that. So how do you explain Are they asking?
Yes.
What? How are they asking? Learning what?
Centuria.
Uh-huh.
So they were learning that, and they asked me how I learned the Bible. I can explain the Bible in a very simple way, but just growing up in their religion, it's hard to express the fundamentals without being overbearing and kind of overpowering. So
well, if they're just asking you how it is you believe in God.
Well, because they want to understand what it is.
Just tell them how it is you believe in God. Well, but they might not be asking you that this is the truth of the life. They're just trying to understand your position, right? Just give them what they ask for. Just honestly tell them what they're asking. And they may say, do you really believe this is true? And then you're going to have to either say yes, no, or something other than that. And they're going to say, well, why? How would you answer that? No, but how would you answer it? Yeah, so say you told them the whole story. They get the whole evangelistic crusade. They get Bible class. They get junior Sabbath school. They sit there and they pay attention to you for like 4 years full time. You know, you work in the next cubicle and yell at the supervisor. And so you yammer on the whole time about it. And it's like they remember what you said more than you do. You know, and you bring them all Ellen White books and they read it and everything. And then they go, do you believe all this stuff? And you go, yeah. And they go, why? Well, what would you say? What does that mean? Does that just mean, because I just do? Here's the reason that I ask. Because if you can't answer them, you're not going to be able to answer you when life craps on you. And you won't be believing it for very much longer. It makes a brittle faith, and that's part of the reason I think that we can benefit from this dangerous process that we're doing. It's not enough to just say, well, we didn't disturb anyone's faith, so they're good. No, they're good until they get dumped just the right way. They're dumped until they're born and their baby's born and it dies. Then they're not good. So what? Why do you believe it? I mean, people, and you can say, I don't even know where to start on that. Well, throughout the history of Christian philosophy, there's some really good thinkers that have thought those thoughts, just like you and I are trying to think of them, and you and I are trying to think of them, and you and I are trying to think of them, and you and I are trying to think of them. They've asked those questions, and then they've said, gee, why do I believe? I mean, I do, but why do I? Should I even? And you've got Anselm. And you've got Aquinas, and you've got Augustine, and you've got Paul, and you've got thinkers today that have been some of the leading atheists of our time that come, at some point they just go, oh darn it, I heard an argument that I think I have to say, I think there's a God. There's people like that that have been like president of the Skeptic Society, literally, that have at one point just had a conversation with somebody. They're honest thinkers. They're really more agnostics than atheists, but they don't believe in God. And they're like quoted by people like Dawkins and Paul Kurtz and people like that are like the people that are really religious atheists, and then they come, and then they say, in one conversation with somebody, shows them some sort of evidence from physics or something, says, oh, what about this? And look at it and go, oh, shoot. I guess there is a God. That happens. You go, I want my hands on that material. I want to read why that happened to them. Wouldn't you? That's part of what studying philosophy does. There's reams of those experiences from philosophers.
Like,
honest is that, though? If you've gotten to the point where you've decided that nothing can change you, when you have a conversation with somebody and you're trying to change them, you're ineligible to have an honest anything with them. You're no longer an honest-minded person. Is that true? Oh, you mean when somebody says, I see that that's true, but I've got too much at stake here, I'd lose my job, it's too expensive?
Yeah.
A spiritual what?
Blindness.
Okay.
Right.
Yes, and I think it happens on both sides of the aisle.
I think you need both.
I mean, I think that I've met people that are ministers that don't believe in God. But they keep that to themselves because they don't know anything else they can do. They don't know how else to support their family and they get little kids. So I don't believe in God. And that's probably part of what the psychology people were trying to ask this character who said, I'm going to try being an atheist for you. I'm not sure they picked the best guinea pig to ask. There's probably some people who are less like grandstanders about it, but in any event, that might be what they were trying to get at was, I don't know, because I didn't ask any of the students or faculty involved in the thing, but grappling with how somebody could say, I know I'm going to kind of give it a trial run or whatever. I don't know what that meant, but I won't know because the person didn't come and say. Maybe that's good, maybe that's not good, but maybe that's part of what's behind it. And on the other hand, you could have somebody who's got a prestigious position in the university, some say Cambridge or Harvard or something, and they're like chair of a department, and somebody asks them straight out, Are you a theist now? No. When actually they've kind of become logically convinced that they have to believe in intelligent design at least. So do you actually believe? Do you think that it's necessary? There's intelligent design, and they're going yes, and they're saying no, because they know they're going to lose their job, and they're not a very good mechanic. Pardon? Their whole identity, their marriage, the respect they have in society, everything could go in the toilet for them because they built their life around not believing. It's a tough deal. Are these like lightweight issues we're talking about here? But you've never thought about any of these things. Some of these things. But some places you just don't say them out loud. Because it's pretty scary. We'll talk a little bit more about it on Thursday. We'll wrestle some more. We'll grapple. Maybe Kyrie shall. Have a nice night. See you on Thursday.